I'm so excited to be sharing with you this morning. What a privilege. And I know that this series is going to be powerful, that God is going to speak to our hearts, His word. So are you ready to receive it this morning? Good. We all love a good underdog story, don't we? Come on, we're Aussies. We all love a good underdog story, yes? All right, we love hearing about people who have the odds stacked against them and then somehow they rise up and overcome adversity to be an unlikely hero. Well, I want to start by telling you a story. It's a true story. Have a listen to this. As an infant, he was largely abandoned to a nanny. In fact, his mother rarely saw him. His dad almost never did. At 7 years old, he was sent to a boarding school where he proved to be literally the worst in the class. His parents got reports that declared their son seems unable to learn anything. He was punished severely, once being dragged into a room and beaten until bloody for school infractions. He changed schools after his nanny discovered welts on his back from the beatings once he was home on a school break. He made no friends at school. His mum rarely visited him and even forgot to send him Christmas presents. His dad also failed to visit him at school ever. Even when he was nearby and his son wrote letters asking him to stop by, his letters were never answered. Dear Dad didn't even know exactly how old his son was. Later as a teen, his father wouldn't let him go to the best school, saying his son would just embarrass him, that he was such a stupid boy. He just couldn't accept that kind of public humiliation from that impudent little idiot. So it means like a defiant little idiot, as he called him. Again, in high school, he did not fare too well, as if to underscore the fact that on visitation days, while other kids' parents came to see their children, his dad never did. The class would march out in rank order. This is horrible. Highest score to the lowest. What a way to build our self-esteem. He was always dead last, and his parents were embarrassed, so he stayed home. He felt the sting of it, as he said, sharply. Certainly, this was a gross understatement. When he proudly wrote to his dad telling him he'd been accepted into military college, his dad finally wrote back saying, "You are a constant disappointment to me. Not only are you a complete failure, I see nothing ahead of you but failure. Do not write to me anymore. I do not wish to hear anything more from you." Thanks, Dad. The same year the son graduated from military college, his dad died in tragic circumstances. He basically cursed his son with the words he spoke. So who is this failure of a son? Who was it that went nowhere and did nothing? Who was it that was hampered by a loveless childhood with a detached mother and a verbally and emotionally abusive father who never understood or cared for his own son? Who was this hapless son from an unhappy family? He was an artist, winning several awards under a pseudonym. He was a very successful author of several books, one winning him the Nobel Prize, making him a wealthy man. He was the lone voice who saw war coming in the appeasement policies Neville Chamberlain brokered with Germany. He was made Prime Minister of England twice and presided over a victory against the spread of Nazism in World War II. And his name? Can you believe that was his childhood? I read that story and I was just like, man, that is amazing. If a man from that background could be an unlikely hero, how many unlikely heroes are in this room today? In this series, we're going to learn from the lives of people that God chose to use despite their flaws, despite their sins, despite even destructive forces at work in their families. And yet they were used by God for His sovereign purposes. And so this morning we're focusing on the story of Rachel and Leah, and I particularly want to draw your attention to Leah because you don't often hear much said about her. And it's a pretty messy story, dysfunctional, painfully raw, at times heartbreaking. But do you know what? You actually couldn't make this stuff up. when you read it, and I don't know if you just read through it, but you're just like, wow, this is a crazy, messed up story. But it's right here in Genesis, in the first book of the Bible, and we're going to talk about it this morning. And we don't actually know that much about Rachel and Leah. We don't know anything about them until their cousin Jacob shows up. After tricking his dad and stealing his brother's birthright and blessing, we read, "So Isaac called for Jacob and blessed him. Then he commanded him," this is in Genesis 28, "do not marry a Canaanite woman. Go at once to Paddan Aram, to the house of your mother's father, Bethuel. Take a wife for yourself there from among the daughters of Laban, your mother's brother." So he's sent off by his father and he's fleeing his brother Esau, who he tricked, and he arrives in this place called Haran. And it's here that he meets his cousin Rachel, who's come down to a well to water the family's sheep. She's a shepherd. And for Jacob, it was fireworks at first sight when he saw Rachel. He's like, "Wowza." And he only had eyes for Rachel from then on. But there's actually no record in the Bible of him stopping and saying, "God, is this who I'm supposed to marry?" The Bible actually doesn't record that he sought God at all about the thought of marrying Rachel. He was impulsive and emotional when he first met her. You know, he wanted to show off his strength, so he rolled away this big stone out of the well and he breaks down and starts weeping, and then he gives her all these kisses, and I think they were just the cultural kisses of, "Oh, my family, welcome," not like weird kisses, all right? He's just met her. But he had found the relatives of his mother, Rebecca, as his dad had instructed him. So I think he was so emotional about that. Wow, God sent me on this, my dad sent me on this mission. I found my family, my mother's family on my mother's side. But his attraction to Rachel was probably quite overwhelming. She was one of Laban's daughters from whom his dad had told him he needed to choose a wife. Jacob's response was basically, "Well, hello, Rachel." He was pretty excited to see her. And so he goes to work for his uncle Laban. He was offered wages in return for working for him. But he agreed to serve Laban for 7 years on the condition that at the end of this time, Rachel could be his wife. And the Bible talks about because of his love for her, those 7 years were like just a few days. And we always hear the story of this romantic love story and, wow, it's amazing. And Jacob certainly was devoted to her. But at this point, you might have been a little bit distracted like I was and going, "She was his cousin. What the? Is anyone thinking that?" Yes? Okay. Well, I want to just talk about that for a moment. In Leviticus 18, God's law was given after Jacob's time, but it does include some specific instruction about various relatives that the people of God were forbidden to marry. Actually, cousin is not on that list. And these days, some studies have shown that children born to first cousin parents have a higher risk of being born with a serious genetic abnormality than children born to non-relatives, and that the risk of early death or major illness is also higher. So while it's not illegal in Australia, the possibility of being shunned by their families and the pain and social stigma associated with first cousin marriage is also the reason many disagree with this practice. But there's some people still in Australia who are forced into arranged marriages with their first cousins. Okay, let's go back to the story. In Genesis 29, verse 16 to 17. Now Laban had two daughters, and the name of the older was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Leah had weak eyes, but Rachel had a lovely figure and was beautiful, and Jacob was in love with Rachel. And you read that and you think, how superficial can you get, Jacob? Like, seriously, I don't know, some of the girls might have thought that, but you just think, why is Leah disqualified because of her weak eyes? Goodness me. But some of the Bible translations use the word tender-eyed when they're talking about weak eyes, which can mean that her sight was weak, or that her eyes lacked this sparkle and fire that was an indication of Middle Eastern beauty in the culture at that time. Whatever the case, she might have been physically quite plain and unattractive. Whatever the case, in Jacob and probably other men's eyes at the time, Leah was down here when compared to Rachel. And it goes on to say, Jacob's sight set on Rachel, around a month after arriving, he asks Laban for her hand in marriage. Laban's an interesting guy. How convenient. He forgets to tell Jacob that it is a custom, it is a practice, that the older daughter is supposed to be given away first. He conveniently forgets to just share that, you know, just that slight little insignificant piece of information. And women didn't even have a choice of who to marry back then, because Leah has weak eyes. Laban knew that the chances of marrying off this daughter, Leah, were very slim. So not only did he scheme a deal with Jacob, not only did he, I think he had it as a plan along, how much can I milk out of this guy to work for me? How much money can I make from him? But he had a trick up his sleeve. Laban pulls a wife swap at the wedding, and he gives his older daughter Leah to Jacob instead of Rachel. And so you might be thinking, how is that possible? Okay, three things. They had no electricity. It's dark at night. Number two, in Middle Eastern culture, often women were veiled on their wedding day. They had a veil on. Number three, I'm sure there was copious amounts of alcohol supplied at the feast on the day of the wedding, and Jacob would have probably partaken. So for all these reasons, he thought he was going into a tent with Rachel, but it was Leah. And so we read in Genesis 29, so Laban brought together all the people of the place and gave a feast. But when evening came, he took his daughter Leah and brought her to Jacob, and Jacob made love to her. And Laban gave his servant Zilpah to his daughter as her attendant. And when morning came, there was Leah. I love it how the Bible is so good at describing that, because it sort of just captures it straight away. You can't, it's so awkward. It's so like, oh, that's just so cringeworthy. But it just says, when the Bible came, there was Leah. Jacob is deceived by his uncle. Of course, he's outraged. Laban makes all these excuses and demands another 7 years' work. I told you this was a messed up story. Like, it's messed up, right? It's crazy. Absolutely crazy. Interestingly, in Leviticus 18, one of the laws Moses did receive and pass on to God's people was this: do not take your wife's sister as a rival wife and have sexual relations with her while your wife is living. So it didn't say anything about cousins, but it says don't take your wife's sister. So understandably, Jacob was heartbroken at this cruel trick. But he now knew that Leah was his wife. He didn't actually stop and think of the implications of marrying Rachel. Laban just says, wait a week, then you can marry her and work for me for another 7 years. And he was just so blinded by his rage, I reckon, and his desire for Rachel. I mean, what if he'd waited a month and just gone, hang on, I just need to think about this. I need to go for a long walk in the bush. I need to have a big conversation with God. What might have the story looked like? But there's no indication in the scriptures that he waited on God or sought God. And I just believe that's a word for some of us here today. Wait for God. Wait for God. Be strong and take heart and wait for God. Don't rush in or react out of your pain. Don't make life-changing decisions that have big future implications on a whim. Don't be duped by the intensity of your feelings. Wait for God. Ask for wisdom. Submit to godly counsel. Look for people who are older and wiser and more discerning than you and say, you know what, I'm thinking of doing this. What do you think? You will save yourself a lot of extra pain. You will avoid a lifetime or a season of regret. Wait until the heat of your emotions have settled. And we don't know whether Leah participated in the deceit to win Jacob from her more beautiful sister. The moral tone of her home was really low, really poor. I mean, you think about it, her mum's not mentioned, and Laban is like shady, quite deceitful, dishonest and greedy man. So maybe she picked up some of those things in her own child as she's growing up. But I want you to think about how Leah might have felt the morning after the wedding night. We read, when morning came, there was Leah. And we all think, oh, poor Jacob. Man, stuck with Leah. How do you think Leah might have felt? Worthless, unwanted, ashamed, embarrassed, and probably a lot of self-hate and guilt because by all accounts, she was silent. She said nothing. Guilty, alone, and abandoned. These words come to mind when I think of how Leah might have been feeling the morning after. And some of you today feel like this. Like a second-rate loser no one wants or sees or cares for. But God sees you. God sees you and he loves you and he cares for you and you're so precious to him. So much so that he sent his son for you. You know, he saw you. He saw where you're at. He saw the family of origin that you grew up in. He saw even the terrible things that might have happened to you. And he came, he sent his son, he gave himself and he came. And he died on a horrible, cruel cross. And he took the weight of our sin and our shame on himself. Because he wanted you to know that you don't have to live a life where you feel abandoned or are alone or are full of guilt and shame. You can belong to him. And he is a personal God. I'm just really aware that right now, some of you, this is getting really real for you. Like maybe you've grown up in church or you've been around situations where you think, yeah, Jesus died for people. That's, thank you, Jesus. But no, he came for you. He came for you. He died for you. He demonstrated his love for you. In Isaiah 59, there's an amazing passage of scripture. It says, surely the arm of the Lord is not too short to save, nor his ear too dull to hear. The Lord looked and was displeased that there was no justice. He saw that there was no one. He was appalled that there was no one to intervene. So his own arm achieved salvation for him, and his own righteousness sustained him. And what a stunning description of Jesus. What a stunning description. His arm is not too short to save anyone, anywhere. His ear is never too dull to hear the desperate, longing, broken cry of the human heart, no matter where you are in the world. You know, I saw this documentary of these people in Ghana, in Accra, Ghana, who literally live on a dump site. There's a city of people who live on a dump site, and God hears the cry of the broken heart of those people just as much as he hears the broken cry of our hearts. And he himself came. He sent Jesus. And Jesus died. He was buried. He was put in this tomb, but he didn't stay dead. And we sang about it this morning. He's risen from the dead and he's alive and he's here by his Holy Spirit because he rose up to be with the Father and he's seated at the right hand of God and he sent his Holy Spirit, his very presence, to come and live in us so we are joined to Jesus forever. Yeah, that's worth a hallelujah. That's worth a praise, God. That's worth an amen, that's for sure. Have a look at this verse in Ephesians chapter 1. It says, in love, he predestined and lovingly planned for us to be adopted to himself as his own children through Jesus Christ. In accordance with the kind intention and good pleasure of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace and favor, which he so freely bestowed on us in the beloved, his son, Jesus Christ. In him we have redemption, that is our deliverance and salvation through his blood, which paid the penalty for our sin and resulted in the forgiveness and complete pardon of our sin in accordance with the riches of his grace, which he lavished on us. What an amazing passage of scripture. And I really feel this morning for us to focus on and be thankful for the riches of his grace. The riches of his grace that are outworked in your life. But the riches of his grace that were being outworked in Leah's life. Because in Genesis 29, verse 31, it says, when the Lord saw that Leah was not loved, when he saw that she was not loved, he saw her. She was worthless in that society. She was just someone to be sold into marriage. But he saw her and he loved her. He took action on her behalf, and his grace, his kindness, his free unearned favor was at work in her life. He opened her womb and she received the blessing of bearing her husband many children, which in that society was how a woman had any sort of esteem and cultural standing. He blessed her to be able to have those children. Despite her pain and her possible involvement in Laban's deception, because of God's grace, Leah is an unlikely hero. She knew that though she was wife number one, her husband pined for wife number two. Imagine living your whole life where you know that someone very close to you, the whole focus of their love is not for you. She lived her whole life with the knowledge of that, and yet she still remained faithful to Jacob and loved him to the end. She is an unlikely hero, and God graced her for that difficult time. She yearns for Jacob to see her, to hear her, to be attached to her. Yet through the pain, she stays connected to God. Even in the disappointments, even when she decided to compete with her sister and take things into her own hands and give her servant Zilpah to Jacob as his wife. Yes, Jacob ends up with four wives. I told you it was a messed up story. But so she could claim these babies as her own children and produce two more sons for Jacob, she took matters into her own hands. Even when she lashed out at her sister and hired out Jacob for the night, she said, "You got to come into my tent." You know, I reckon every night Jacob was in Rachel's tent. Imagine the loneliness of that. And she said, "You know what? No, you've got to come into my tent because I've given some plant stuff that my son found that's supposed to help with infertility. You can have that, Rachel, but I get to stay with Jacob tonight." She was hiring out her husband. Even as she manipulated and tried to justify this behavior, with each birth, Leah gave her six sons names that expressed her hopes and prayers in God. When you read through the list of their names. So God's grace was at work in Leah right there in the midst of a most difficult situation. His kindness sustained her and shaped her to be an unlikely hero. And the riches of his grace can shape you into an unlikely hero too. If you've had words that have been spoken over you, if you've had everything stacked against you, when you belong to Jesus, God speaks blessing. He speaks the highest blessing over you. He says, "You are my child, you're my beloved, you know, I've won you to myself. This is who you are in Christ now." He blesses you. And when he blesses you, you can't be cursed. There are times when Leah must have pleaded with God to change her situation. In 2 Corinthians 12, the Apostle Paul speaks of pleading with Jesus to take away a physical affliction or temptation in his life. We read it in the first part of verse 9 in that chapter. Jesus responded to him and he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in your weakness." And I think of lots of times when I've had those same sorts of prayers with God. I'm sure you've got some that you might be praying even right now. "Please, Lord, change this situation. Please, Jesus, take this area of struggle away. Please, remove this hard part of following you because this is so hard." And you know what his word to you and I is this morning? It is, "My grace is sufficient. It's enough for you. My power, my dunamis, my energy, my power is made perfect in your weakness." His power is made perfect and he gets the glory by working in and through me despite my weakness. The riches of his grace can shape you into an unlikely hero to leave a lasting and eternal impact to the lives of others around you. As you point them to Jesus, and I just feel in this room too, there's some of you who right now, the investment that you're making into the kingdom of God that is costly, you need to know that generations that come after you are going to be impacted by what you're investing right now. There's a legacy that you're leaving. the generations who will come after you. And you can't even see, you can't even begin to imagine what God is doing and what God is preparing for those who come after you as you are faithful to his call in your life. Praise the Lord. Lean on his grace. Don't just think about it for your salvation. Lean on it every day. Rest in it. Remember and put the full weight of your trust in his kindness. Depend on his favor because you have it in Christ Jesus. Rely on his power working through you. Release your faith and do what he asks. And even if the circumstances don't change right now, even if they never do, you have Jesus and you have the promise of the power of God working in your situation, and the Bible tells us that is enough. That is enough. It is sufficient. The riches of God's grace shape us into unlikely heroes as we cooperate with him, as we say, yeah, God, have access into this part of my life. But I want to share with you another thing, and I've particularly chosen these words so you'll remember them. You ready? God chooses to use losers. Don't forget that one. God chooses to use losers. So good. Leah couldn't see the grand master plan God was outworking in and through her life, but God had chosen her to be the mother of six sons who would become half of the tribe of Israel, God's people, and that through that, Jesus would come. That's amazing. Time and time again, we see it in the Bible, God chooses to use losers. They're not really losers to God, you understand that, right? Sometimes we're just losers in our own eyes or in other people's eyes, but God considers us precious. He made us. We're not losers. But it's just sometimes we see ourselves like that. To quote Rick Warren, who's an influential church leader and author of the book, The Purpose-Driven Life, some of you need to hear this. Abraham was old. Jacob was insecure. Leah was unattractive to her husband. Joseph was abused. Moses stuttered. Gideon was poor. Samson was codependent. Rahab was immoral. David had an affair and all kinds of family problems. Elijah was suicidal. Jeremiah was depressed. Jonah was reluctant. Naomi was a widow. John the Baptist was eccentric, to say the least. Peter was impulsive and hot-tempered. Martha worried a lot. The Samaritan woman had several failed marriages. Zacchaeus was unpopular. Thomas had doubts. Paul had poor health. And Timothy was timid. If that's not a list of losers, I don't know what is. And God chooses to use. Doesn't that make you feel good? If God can use them, he can use me. That's awesome. Well, you might be saying, that's not me. I'm quite respectable. And I could contribute a lot to God's team. I've got a good resume. Well, I just encourage you, none of us have it all together. If we think like that, we actually probably limit God using us. We need to be humble enough to say, before I was in Christ, yeah, I was a loser. But Jesus chose me. We're no longer losers, but adopted sons and daughters of God. Have a listen to this in Ephesians 1. Again, it says, blessed and worthy of praise be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed or spoken well of us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms in Christ, just as in his love he chose us in Christ. He actually selected us for himself as his own. Before the foundation of the world, so that we would be holy, that is consecrated, set apart for him, purpose-driven, and blameless in his sight. In him also we have received an inheritance, a destiny. We were claimed by God as his own, having been predestined, chosen, and appointed beforehand, according to the purpose of him who works everything in agreement with the counsel and design of his will, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ, who first put our confidence in him as our Lord and Saviour, so that we would exist to the praise of his glory. Do you know, unlikely heroes know that they exist for God's glory. They actually exist for the Lord's glory. This life is actually not about them. It's actually about Him. And I see so many unlikely heroes in this room. I see it. Some of you don't see it about yourself. You're like, what? Who's she talking to? Not me. This is a word for you this morning. You need to start agreeing with God. You need to ask Him to give you a vision on the inside of how He sees you. Read Ephesians chapter 1 and put your own name in there. You need to get a vision on the inside. Fan into flames like a fire in your belly. Long before He created the world, He loved me and He chose me in Christ to be holy and without fault in His eyes. Come on, that's true. Let's lift our faith to what He's done for us. He wants to use us. He will use us as we give Him access to our hearts. For some of us, He's using us, but He wants to enlarge our capacity. He doesn't want us to just stay static or stuck. He wants to enlarge our capacity to the praise of His glory. He wants us to bless and reach our families, our neighbours, those we work with. He wants to use us together through this local church in ways we could never imagine. Stop doubting, stop making excuses, stop disqualifying yourself, stop listening to lies, stop holding back, stop worrying about what others might think of you, stop trying to make it happen or manipulate things or strive to be seen by others. Stop stressing over the fact that you can't handle the bigness of what God has got for you, because guess what? You can't. He will do it in and through you. He will do it in and through you. He is faithful to do it. And from the first and the last, He wants us to start to agree with what He says. I am God's workmanship. I want us to confess that today. If you are here as our guest, you don't have to say this, but why don't we join in together if we're a Bible-believing Christ follower. Say it with me. I am God's workmanship. Next bit is created in Christ Jesus. Say it with me. Created in Christ Jesus to do good works that God has prepared in advance for me to do. When you get up in the morning, when you're driving along, you're like, oh, catch yourself and you say, I'm such a loser. No, you're not. You are God's workmanship. That song, Here I Am, Send Me. You know what that song is? It's a song saying, use everything I am, use everything I'm not, just use me to the praise of your glory. Because you know, when God uses us like that, people go, that can't have been Cass, or that can't have been Michael. That has to be God. Because they can't do that sort of thing on their own. They're just pretty ordinary. That has to be God. Agree with His word. Let there be an emptying of yourself. Bow down before Him and admit your dependence on Him and ask Him to fill you with His Spirit. We see this with Leah. After she gives birth to her fourth son, you know, the previous three names that she gives her son, she said, oh, I'll call him this, but maybe now my husband will love me. Maybe now my husband will see me. Maybe now my husband will be attached to me. But when she gets to Judah, you know what she just says? This time, I will praise the Lord. No conditions. I'm going to just love Him. I'm just going to love Him and say, here I am, send me. And you know what proceeds from her faith in naming Judah her son, which means praise? Judah is in the genealogy of Jesus. When you read it in Matthew chapter 1, he's a tribe that Jesus came from. When you read Revelation chapter 5, you hear about a description about Jesus which says he is the lion of the tribe of... Yeah. It came out of faith. And what comes out of faith lasts. It is eternal. Because it's agreeing with God and His word. Leah lived on this earth for the praise of Jesus' glory, and in her death, Jacob finally acknowledged and esteemed her as his wife. It says in Genesis 49, when he was giving his sons his final instructions, bury me in that place where my fathers are buried, where Abraham and Sarah, where Isaac and Rebecca are buried, and where I buried Leah. He didn't bury Rachel there. Bury me there with Leah. That's amazing. I think that's God's commendation. Well done, good and faithful servant. Unlikely heroes exist for the praise of his glory, the riches of God's grace, which are available to each one of us. They shape us into unlikely heroes as we cooperate with him. God chooses losers, recreates them in Christ, and makes them into his adopted sons and daughters. God can use you. We exist for the praise of his glory. It's all because of him. Why don't we pray together?